I get it. And see, Bette Davis did not respect Joan Crawford, and Joan Crawford could have had, she could have had the role. Bette Davis would have been, just because Bette Davis, like you said, the work. Acting was everything to her. So if she'd have got the Blanche role, she'd have been okay with that. Joan Crawford,
yeah.
I don't think she would have, they just didn't match. And I'm not taking anything away from Joan Crawford. And I know we got Joan Crawford fans out there. You all know Joan Crawford would not have done the Baby Jane Hudson's role any justice like Betty, okay? Because that's just not the type of actress she was, and that's okay. But Betty could play an oven mitt, and you'd be like, oh, that's the best freaking oven mitt I've ever seen in my life. I was crying when the oven mitt came out on the stage. You know, that's just who Bette Davis is. I think another fun fact is that Bette Davis said that the wig, so once they started beefing behind the scenes, the wig that she uses for Baby Jane, the curly, the pigtail one, according to her, I don't know how true it is, that was an actual wig from a Joan Crawford movie, The Hussy. Now, I don't know how, because I saw that movie, The Hussy, and Joan Crawford's wig in that was not blonde. As to my memory, I've seen a long time ago, and anybody in the comments section, let us know, you know, if you have any info on that. But that's what Bette Davis said. She intentionally got that wig to taunt Joan Crawford. Girl, that's some demon stuff. That's hilarious to me. That's so fun. That's how much they hated each other. So she got that wig to tone her. And on Dick Cavett, this is one of her Dick Cavett interviews back in the day. And she also said, when she originally did the scene where she's imitating Blanche's voice on the phone to order some liquor or something like that, she said originally she did Joan Crawford's voice. But Betty told Dick Cavett, she said, but the woman was so mad, meaning insane, talking about Joan Crawford, got so mad that Betty could ape her and mock her. She went to Aldred and threw a fit. I don't want her to do my voice. I can do my own voice. So Aldred, he just wanted to keep the peace. He said, okay. So they dubbed in Joan Crawford, dubbing in, doing, and Bette Davis doing Joan Crawford. And so everybody erupted into laughter on Dick Cavett's on YouTube. She said the woman was absolutely mad. She said she was insane. And I was like, yeah. So apparently Betty was winning in life and her career and the movie behind the scene with Joan Crawford. That is incredible. But Joan Crawford got her back. Tell the audience who don't know, those who don't know, how did Joan Crawford like stab Bette Davis in the heart? How did she get her back?
Oh boy. Okay. So what she did was she went to different actresses who were playing on stage in theater, the ones that she knew would not be able to be present to accept the Academy Award. And so she went to them individually. She said, well, would you let me go ahead and accept the award for you? Since, you know, you're in your play and you can't, you know, be away from the stage production that you're doing. Would you let me do it? And they say, oh, yeah, yeah. You know, she was all sweetness and light. And behind the scenes, Joan Crawford was campaigning against Bette Davis to get the Oscar. So what happens is Anne Bancroft wins that year for The Miracle Worker. And so, I know, right? And so there's Betty. She's standing there at the wings of the stage. Backstage. Yes. It's ready to go there and accept that Oscar. And all of a sudden they say, and the winner is Anne Bancroft. And here comes Joan Crawford sailing right past her. Sitting and say, excuse me. Almost like
step aside.
So there she is, Joan Crawford, standing there with the Oscar, accepting for Anne Bancroft is Joan Crawford.
Yes.
Don't you know Betty is
livid. She could have killed her. So it was after that she hated her like poison. She hated her. And then here comes the line when Joan Crawford died, somebody called and asked, a journalist or whatever, asked her, you know, how do you feel about Joan Crawford's passing? And you know the famous line, she said, well, if you can't say anything good about somebody, you shouldn't say anything at all. Joan Crawford's dead. Good. Like, just shade. Shade, shade, shade. Girl, I love it. And that's just what makes us love Betty even more. And makes us love Joan Crawford, because Joan Crawford, she could dish it, but she couldn't take it out. She couldn't take it a lot of time. And then if they had a bigger dog, you know, because she wasn't going to beat Betty Davis, because like somebody said, Betty Davis was a wordsmith. You know, she was really, just really witty and really just blunt. And so, she, you know, Joan didn't have that skill. So she just fought Betty how she could. You know, they, hey, man, they got some good blows in. So we're better people for it, for all the drama. But just a shout out in the cast, we had Victor Buono, how do you say his name? Maddie Normans played the maid, Elvira. Anna Lee was in it. She was the neighbor. And BD, Betty Davis's daughter, was Anna Lee's daughter, Mrs. Bates' daughter. So she was in there for a little bit. So a lot of people in there. And like I said, this is the little movie that could, because nobody knew what this movie was going to turn into. And look at it. It's iconic. You can look at it at least once a year or more, and just, it's so delicious, as we like to say.
Yes, it is. And for women, these two were in their mid-50s when they made this movie, and roles for women at that age were just non-existent. And for them to be revitalized like this again, and to have their career given a start because of this movie, this was like almost like a historic event in Hollywood.
Yes.
I mean, because you'd never seen a movie quite like this before. All psychological and just, unlike anything anybody had seen before. And it spawned, you know, so many other movies, another whole genre. You know, there was like Hush Hush, Sweet Charlotte, and The Nanny, and then all these other movies that followed because of this one.
Right,
because
Dead Ringer was 2 years later, and then Stray Jacket, Dead Ringer, Betty Davis. Remember, check out our video on YouTube. We did that. Then Joan Crawford went on to do Stray Jacket, both in 64. And so, you know, of course, Betty had the better career and, you know, and had better roles and such, because she's Betty Davis. But yeah, thank you for pointing that out, Georgia, because yeah, this really did help. And then other older actresses, they started, like you say, the hag thriller, hag horror became a genre. So then we saw other actresses who hadn't been on screen, and you know, like you mentioned, Tallulah Bankhead did something, and Shelley Winters and other people. So these ladies paved the way once again for women to get back in. So please check out Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, 1962. Again, YouTube has a lot of back stuff on there, behind the scenes. So thank you guys. Don't forget, we are on Facebook at How Betty Davis Saved My Life, Life Lessons from Classic Hollywood. And the life lesson from this, Georgia, is, you know, age. If you got the talent and you believe in yourself and you know you got the goods, go out there and get it, man. Go and do the work. Lay the foundation. You know, Betty and Joan had laid the foundation. They were stars, consummate stars and professionals. If that's how you are in your life, you know, make your own way. Your way will be made for you. You just got to go out there and do it. It's already there. And that's it. Like I said, we're on Facebook. We got our YouTube videos. We look forward to seeing you guys the next time. Remember, always, you are the star of your own show, man, and that's the life you make. So for How Betty Davis Saved My Life, I'm Moya, and ma'am, you are?
Georgia!
That's right, my girl, my ace in the hole, Georgia. You guys take care. We look forward to seeing you next time. Shaka, take us on out. that's it.
That was fun, Moya.